Hey, what's up, everyone? Welcome back to another episode of the Venom Vlog. And today we are going to cover quite a bit of Flash Thompson Venom comic books, Agent Venom stuff. We have issue 15, which is called Home Again. And that's going to be the first one we start off with. And then I'm just going to throw in all of the Secret Avengers stuff that Rick Remender wrote, which I think was like issue 21.1, I think around that time, or issue 22. Like they started around then. And, because obviously there was 20 issues of the book already. But then I think when Rick Remender came on to, to bring the team in a new direction, make a new leader for the team, switching it from Captain America to Hawkeye, they brought in a couple new members like Beast from the X-Men and stuff. So, and Valkyrie, from Thor's universe. So they have all of these like, great characters put together to fight life model decoys. So we're going to talk a little bit about that and how Venom joins the team. And then we're going to end the episode with issue 16 of Agent Venom, which is called Clemency. And it's a standalone story that it kind of is like the last precursor before Remender's last run on Venom, which is called the Savage Six. And then he does like a little bookend single issues at the beginning and end of those. So we'll cover all that in an upcoming episode. But this, we have a lot of ground to cover, and I want to try to get through it and not take too much time. So I'm going to try to keep this around 30 minutes, even though I'm going over enough books to probably talk for an hour or two. So I'll do my best. Luckily for the Secret Avengers stuff, there's not a ton of Venom, really. Like there, he's got a role to play, but it's not like focused on him because obviously there's a team dynamic going on, and there's other things going on, and there's a big focus on the villain. So luckily, that'll ease us off of some of the Venom talk on that one. So we start off with issue 15 here from Agent Venom, and it starts off with Hybrid actually coming back into the fold. So obviously, we knew that those four Life Foundation symbiotes went off and became Hybrid, and they connected to that guy who was like a hero, member of like the New Warriors and stuff, or friends with the New Warriors, and so he's out there still running around, helping people, I guess. And what happens at the beginning of this is he's found by somebody, and he's trapped, knocked out from the sky because he was like swinging around like Spider-Man style, then gets brought down into an alley, and then that's when Eddie Brock shows up, and Eddie Brock straight up kills him and the symbiote with like really intense weaponry. So we have an Eddie Brock here that I feel this, because I'm sure Swordsman or some other people might have different opinions on this one, but for me, like it feels like a 180. Like we saw Eddie and he kind of like saved New York and kind of had this like religious thing going on where he's like had a God complex where he's like, hey, I can cure all of you, just come up here and I'll cleanse you with the anti-venom symbiote that he had. And then he ended up saving New York City from the Spider Island stuff. So now he seems to have kind of turned around, or maybe you can argue he kept going in the path he was going with like kind of a God complex, where now he's like, you know what, I hate symbiotes. And I want to go around and destroy them, and I'm going to build myself back up to killing Venom, because now he's seen that Venom is, public knowledge now. Like Agent Venom has been seen in places like Vegas and stuff, saving people. So now Eddie Brock's like, okay, I got to step up my game here, and I got to start taking out the other symbiotes that are still alive out there, like the Life Foundation symbiotes. So I'm going to go take them down, and then I'll work my way up to Venom, and I'm sure Toxin will come along the way and stuff like that. So it starts off, yeah, that's where we are when we start. And we have Hybrid being killed by Eddie Brock. So it's like, okay, so already off the bat, we have someone hunting symbiotes. So that adds a little of a ticking time clock to Flash Thompson and his days as Agent Venom. And after everything he's been through, being kind of pulled away from the government now and then saving Las Vegas, and now he has a hell mark on him that he's not fully aware of, but Damien Hellstrom is. Now that he has that, and he's kind of won the approval in a way of Captain America. Captain America has decided, you know what, we're putting together a new team of Secret Avengers. I'm not going to be in charge of it, although he still kind of is in charge a little bit. But he wants to hand the team over to Hawkeye. And he's kind of testing Hawkeye when we get into the Secret Avengers stuff. We'll get there in a second, but he's kind of testing Hawkeye. So he wants to hand him the team. But before that, in issue 15, we get a peek into what Remender's doing for Secret Avengers, which is they go to the Lighthouse space station, which is a giant space station that gets shrunk down by Ant-Man to be microscopic out in space, which is kind of neat because they're like, we're in a giant space shuttle out in, or a space station out in space. Our enemies are going to know where we are. They're going to be able to find us with satellites, or if enemies come from outside of Earth's atmosphere, they're going to see us on their way in. And Ant-Man's like, no, they're not, because I shrunk all of you guys down to like nano size. So that's pretty cool. So they have a mini space station floating around in space out there, which a lot of technology has to go into that, because I'm sure like a little crumb floating through space is not, I don't know. I mean, there's no gravity, so I guess it's the same as putting something big out in space. But anyway, we get introduced to the team here. So we have Giant Man, and I think it's Giant Man, but it's not Goliath, I don't think. I think it's Hank Pym. Him and Hank McCoy, Beast from the X-Men, Hank McCoy has joined this team as well, and they have come up with a way to sedate the symbiote. So that's my only problem with the Secret Avengers run, and we'll get into that in a second, is that there's not a lot of talking between Flash and the symbiote, and it's because it's being hit with this drug that that you remember they used to do that with Agent Venom. They'd be like, all right, you can go out for 24 hours and then you got to come back because the serum we're going to give the symbiote, it's only going to kind of sedate it and let you have control of it for about 24 hours and then you got to get back here. Same thing here. They find a way to improve the drug because obviously over time it wasn't working anymore on the symbiote. So Hank McCoy and Hank Pym figured out how to, make the serum a little bit more intense so the symbiote can't fight back against it. So basically, like, we're going to keep it in a jar here in the space station. And you only get it when we want you to, and you get it for 24 hours, and then you got to give it right back to us. And Flash is like, man, you guys couldn't do anything about the 24-hour stuff, huh? And they're like, we're still figuring out what symbiotes are. And Beast is like, this is the first time I got to actually study one. So, this is kind of fascinating for me, but I'll figure it out and, whatever. So I kind of like that. I was like, yeah, I love Beast from X-Men. He's one of my favorite characters on the team. So it's so cool. I always liked him when he went over to the Avengers side. It was always neat. So seeing him here is really cool. They also introduce Valkyrie, and Valkyrie, as we know, is a warrior from the Asgard realm, kind of, and she's a total BA. She's a badass, and so she actually is on the team, and she kind of takes a liking a little bit to Flash Thompson. In fact, Flash even calls her beautiful, and he's just giving her a compliment. He's not like really hitting on her. He's just kind of like, hey, thanks for the, because she's like, oh, you as Venom, you could be a mighty warrior for the team. And he's like, oh, that's very nice of you to say. He's like, well, having a Valkyrie here is great too. You're very tough, you're awesome, and you're quite beautiful. And then she's like, you think I'm beautiful? And he's like, oh, yeah, I'm not hitting on you or anything. And she's like, you're not hitting on me? So there's kind of some fun banter there, which I kind of liked, because at this point, Flash did kind of break it off with Betty. And we don't know really where they stand, but we're going to find out in this issue that they do not stand together anymore, unfortunately, which is really sad because obviously they're both good people, but Flash just went way off the rails when he went to Vegas and he was drinking again. And obviously he was trying to do it to keep Betty protected. He didn't want the Crime Master and Jack-O-Lantern to come get her and stuff. So he was, and he was on the run from the government in a way with the symbiote. So he didn't want to have her get involved in that. But unfortunately, that's, it's kind of tearing them apart and you're kind of bummed because you're like, oh, these are two good people. I want them to be together, like Peter and Mary Jane or whatever. So it's a little bit of a bummer, but it looks like he might have kind of a rebound girl here, actually. And that's not to just say Valkyrie's just a rebound girl. She kind of likes Flash, like, actually. And you think it's just like a physical thing at first, but you find out in Secret Avengers, it's a little bit more like that. Cause I guess she doesn't get a lot of compliments. I guess a lot of guys are intimidated by her, which, I would be too. She's a badass who can kill like dragons and stuff. So yeah. So it was kind of cool. So they have this fun little banter, and so he goes back to Earth, and this whole rest of this issue is him talking to Peter Parker, and getting some kind of clarification there. And he's admitting to Pete, like, look, I screwed up. Betty is, I think she's gonna take me back this time, and I don't blame her. So, I need help, just to get my life back on track, even if it doesn't include Betty, and you're a guy who's bounced back from tough things before, so can you help me? So I kind of like that. They had a great moment there. And meanwhile, while they're kind of connecting and stuff, and then Flash is on his way to meet with Betty, that's when Donna Diego shows up, Scream, and she was called, by someone. She's like, all right, going in the sewer. She's like, where are you? I got your message. What's going on? And then that's when, Eddie shows up and hits her with like a sonic beam and a fire, like a bright light thing that blinds her temporarily and the symbiote. And then he pulls out these two knives that he was, grilling. I guess he had them in like in a little furnace and they were heating up. And he uses these two knives and he cuts her apart and kills her, which is intense. Like, and Eddie looks like his eyes are whited over. Like, he looks kind of just full on sociopathic and serial killer in a way. And it's pretty crazy. It's like I said, it feels like a departure for the direction he was going in as someone who got all these accolades and had heroes saying, hey, you did a great job from saving anyone. And now he's essentially a symbiote serial killer. But he's not just killing the symbiotes, he's killing their hosts too, which seems way too intense and extreme for me. Like, I feel like if he hates symbiotes, why not just kill the symbiotes? Like, find a way to pull them off the host and destroy them. But he's killing the host too. And it just seems, I don't know, for me, maybe you guys have a different opinion. Let me know down below if you disagree, but I feel like it's just too intense for what Eddie has been through. It's you know, and there was a time where he was willing to kill Aunt May, but that was part of his redemption arc, is that he chooses not to. So it just kind of feels like it spits in the face of that kind of stuff. So I would say I'm not a big fan of that with Remender on this, is that he's to prop Flash up, he's tearing Eddie down and making him more of a villain. And I feel like I hate when writers do that, when they're like, oh, I like this Green Lantern, so I'm gonna write this one better than the other ones. And it's like, they're all great, like, you know, and Eddie, you know, I don't know, you could have had anyone else hunting symbiotes, and they could have been framing Eddie. That would have been an even cooler story, I think. So anyway, Flash and Peter are still reminiscing, and then Flash goes and talks to his mother and says, "Hey, I'm sorry I wasn't there after Dad died, and I wasn't there for you, and I apologize." And then at the end, he talks to Betty, and basically they get their closure, you know, between them. So you know, and she says like, "We're never getting back together." She like Taylor Swift them. She's like, you know, "We're never ever ever getting back together." And so yeah, so it's over between them. And I think that's what opens Flash up to entertain the thought of being with Valkyrie. So now we cut over to Secret Avengers, and some of this takes place before issue 15, but most of it is just setting up the team. It's Bogalia, this country, this nation that is kind of like a tech nation in a way, and they're kind of secluded from the outside world. And you have a Captain America and Hawkeye sneaking into it like spies, and trying to find out who's behind some of the new rising of power inside this nation, this Bogalia nation. And what they learn is that it's Max Fury, who is a life model decoy of Nick Fury. So he has all of Nick Fury's thoughts. Like, he knows every secret Nick Fury knows, is been transferred into this robot cyborg that looks like Nick Fury, the original Nick Fury. And so his name's Max Fury. And he's pulled together a team of cybernetically enhanced people, or flat out robots that were created, like Hank Pym. You know, he's built Ultron and other robots and stuff, like Vision and stuff, or you know, however that worked out. And then in this, you have Max Fury. That's kind of, he's got like an evil Ghost Rider named the Spirit of Pollution on his side, and he's got like, I think the Reavers show up at one point from the X-Men. There's Lady Deathstrike from the X-Men is there, and you have and they team, they make some interesting bedfellows. They team up with like Frankenstein and kind of the evil brother Voodoo from another realm, and they go to Otherworld, which is something Rick Remender set up in his Uncanny X-Force run that involves Captain Britain, who then joins the team. So yeah, you have Captain Britain, Black Widow, Hawkeye, Beast, Valkyrie, and Giant Man, and they have Venom joins the team eventually. But Venom does not join the way everyone else does. Like, basically Hawkeye is shown his team by Captain America, and then Cap is like, after they go on this mission, the spy mission, and they're trying to save this woman who has a small child, and the woman has this power where like there's terrorists around and they want to go bomb, you know, places, and they open their shirt to bomb her and where her and her son are, and she's able to like breathe in the fire after the bomb goes off and then spits it back at some of the other guys. So she's super powered, and what they find out is that she's kind of a creation. She's like a built human, like a sentient life form in a way, like a AI kind of thing, like Ultron and those kind of, and the other people that are teaming up with Max Fury. So she's of them, and they all kind of perceive themselves as you know, like as children to the father, and the father is you know, a single individual who's like had a hand in creating all of them in some regard. And then above them, they have the, or not really in creating all of them, but I guess being one of the early versions of a cyborg. And so he's kind of running the show. And then above him, you have Jim Hammond, who's the original Human Torch from the days of the Defenders, way back in World War II, where you had Captain America, Human Torch, and Namor teaming up together to you know, to fight you know, Nazis and stuff like that. And so those characters, Jim Hammond shows up in this as a cyborg, and all the robots refer to him as grandfather. So they have father, who's kind of running the evil show, not Max Fury, like, but he's working with Max Fury. And then you have grandfather, who's Jim Hammond. And so all that kind of plays in. So it's very complicated. If you're, I'm not a big Avengers fan, so a lot of these references, I'm like, they probably went way over my head. Some of them I can kind of piece together. So I defer to you guys. If you're bigger fans of me and know about all this stuff, feel free to let me know in the comments anything I get wrong. I'm just going off what I read here. And I did feel a little lost at times, but also Remender did a pretty good job of making it accessible enough to where I'm like, okay, I can follow the story at least. Bad guys are AIs, and they want to control the world and wipe out civilization and humanity, and they want to use it with this like evil crown helmet, that has like Medusa snakes coming out of it, and it allows you to like brainwash all humans. So at one point, Max Fury tries to put that on, but it doesn't work because he doesn't have a soul, because he's an AI. And he was like, no, I thought I would have one. Like, I'm a living being. So Taskmaster ends up taking it and putting it on. And Taskmaster, who was the grunt of Max Fury and the father, decides to say, screw both of you guys. You both were going to screw me over and get me killed. So I'm going to take this crown now and put it on. And now I'm going to possess people around the world. So he takes control of Hawkeye and Black Widow and uses them as, you know, to their bidding, which reminded me of like the Avengers movies, you know, where everyone gets kind of brainwashed in the first movie, or some of them do, by Loki. So it had a little bit of that to it, but it's very much like a spy type story, the Secret Avengers books. And there's three volumes that Rick Remender did. And so it's Rick Remender's volumes 1, 2, and 3, but I think it's issues 21 to like 34 or 35, somewhere in there. So it's a pretty good amount of issues. It's like, you know, 12, 13 issues. And there's a couple one shots in there and like an annual and stuff. And there's some things that tie into AVX, which was the Avengers versus X-Men event that was happening at the time. And those three issues, I was actually really surprised. No venom in any of them. So that's what I mean. Like, it's pretty easy to breeze through this run because there's not a ton of venom in it. Although, you know, he pops up like the first three issues, no venom. Then finally in the third issue, they introduce Venom being on the team, and Hawkeye's not happy with it. He's like, look, you already picked Captain Britain and Black Widow and you know, Beast and Hank Pym and everyone. And he's like, and I get it. Like, they're all, some of them have all had connections in Valkyrie. Like, they have dealings with Avengers and stuff before. But he's like, are you serious? You're going to put Venom on this team? Venom's a killer. And Cap's like, yes, there have been previous versions of Venom that are killers and evil, you know, and have been evil. But this guy, Flash, has proven himself. And he saved Las Vegas recently from, you know, Mephisto's or Blackheart's, you know, attempt at, you know, a coup on his father, Mephisto. And he's like, so I'm willing to give this guy a chance and trust him. And he's like, and so Hawkeye actually had a great line. He goes, oh, really, Captain America? You trust this guy? He's like, okay, so when did you tell Spider-Man that Venom was going to be an Avenger? And Cap was like, yeah, I didn't tell Spider-Man. He's like, yeah, okay. So you don't really trust this at all because you don't want this to blow up in your face, basically. So there was things I liked and didn't like about that. I mean, I like Captain America a lot as a character, but him having these like secret things and like manipulating people like he's Batman on some level, I'm like, he's not that kind of character. He's very blunt and straightforward. And I know characters can change and evolve, and Cap has certainly been through the ringer and a lot of stuff, and he's been evil and he's been all these things, but it's like, to me, I wasn't really digging Remender's Captain America. I think he even went on to write Captain America Monthly, and I remember reading some of that and then dropping that book pretty quickly. So maybe it's just one of those things where I'm just not a fan of Remender's take on Captain America, but I didn't really like it in this. I found myself, it's again, it seemed like to prop Hawkeye up, he tore Cap down a little bit. And I'm like, I just don't like when writers do that. I like complexity between characters, and just because I like Cap doesn't mean I always have to be on his side regarding an issue or something like that, or a debate, or where he stands on something. But the manipulation stuff he was doing just felt a little not Captain America. And so I kind of started thinking, oh, maybe he's a life model decoy, or maybe he's like a plant for the bad guys. But turns out he wasn't, but the current Ant-Man, Eric O'Grady, he is. And so at one point in the story, he actually is a plant for the bad guys, but it's only because he starts off, because he's like a criminal bad guy, he joins the Secret Avengers and because as a second chance to do better. And he actually does try to save the child's life. The mom, who's like has superpowers, who turns out to be an AI, she gets taken away by the bad guys. And then at one point they have to, you know, fight against her and she gets shut down. But Ant-Man, Eric O'Grady, is able to save her son and get him out, like teleport him away and save him and get him to the next checkpoint where other Avengers can go get him. But then Eric, because he's dead, he gets put, you know, they put cybernetic parts in him and they bring him back as the Black Ant, and they put him into send him back to his teammates, you know, that, and he looks alive, and they send him back there to be the infiltrator of the team. So when Max Fury gets taken down and he gets arrested by the Secret Avengers, Black Ant is able to kill him, get some information out of him, and bring that back to the father. And then they plan their big final coup in the final third volume of this, where it's AI machines and brainwashing people and then fighting against, you know, humanity and the Secret Avengers having to do their best to stop them. And it's pretty cool because, like I said, in the third issue, they finally bring in Venom and he meets the team, and, you know, they don't really hit it off with him too well at first because they're all like, oh, it's Venom. Valkyrie's the only one who kind of gives him a chance. So they start, you know, talking. Like he's like the only she's like the only friend he kind of has at first. Hank McCoy and Hank Pym kind of talk to Flash, but it's mainly about the symbiote. So they're just being scientist nerds. So they don't really not really connecting to Flash too much on too much of a personal level. So Flash ends up teaming up with Valkyrie a lot, and then it gets to the point where they start feeling an attraction to each other. And right before they get double crossed by Black Ant, they even sleep together. And at this point, Flash, there's part of him, he's like, I still love Betty, but her final words in issue 15 were, we're never getting back together again, and and I don't want you in my life anymore. So at this point, he's like, well, I guess why can't I be happy? And this is a woman who I don't have to worry about protecting really in any way because she could kick my ass. He's like, so yeah, let's give it a shot. And so they hook up, and I actually kind of like the relationship. Honestly, I have so much so now that I'm reading this, I'm like, man, I wish when Flash Thompson died, I wish they would have showed. And I don't know if maybe I'll have to go back and read Red Goblin. We will on the show. We haven't covered that yet, but we will at some point. I think it's, I hope that Valkyrie visited Flash Thompson's grave. Like that would have been a nice touch. And I feel like someone probably did it already, but if they didn't, I feel like that's a missed opportunity because I really like their relationship in here. And they hook up, and at one point she die almost dies saving Flash because they get betrayed by Black Ant, Deathstrike, Lady Deathstrike, and the cyborg people show up. They blow a hole through their space station and they get sucked out into space. But then Flash, does a Hail Mary pass, finds a way to get the symbiote, or like a fire breaks out and the symbiote breaks out of its cell that the jar it's hidden in, and it comes in, bonds with Flash, and then he goes out into space, wraps around Valkyrie, and brings her back into the space station. So I thought that was pretty cool. And so then from there, they go down to Earth and they help fight in the final battle, and Flash and Valkyrie play a major part in the final battle. She gets brainwashed at first, and Flash has to kind of shake her loose from it. And once he does, she admits to him, she's like, was it, he's like, was it just lust between us? And she said, it was more than lust. Like, I actually have feelings for you. So it's like, man, that's pretty good. Like, because I like seeing good characters like Flash happy to an extent. And although I love Betty, this was just one of those relationships where I'm like, if I was writing this, I never would have thought of that. I never would have thought of having Flash hook up with Valkyrie. But I really dig it. Actually, that was my favorite part of the Secret Avengers run, was that relationship and kind of how it grew. And it felt pretty good, like organically. Like for something to happen so quickly, it grew pretty well and pretty organically. But the first three issues didn't really have Flash in it. And then during that whole Avengers for X versus X-Men thing, right before they get double crossed, they did a three issues of Avengers versus X-Men in there, and that was kind of meh. It was basically Captain Marvel and Thor teaming up with some of the members of the team. No Flash though. Flash was on Earth, I guess, not around during this time. Maybe the events of Savage Six are happening, and I don't know. He wasn't on the ship though, so it's them trying to prevent the Phoenix from coming to Earth to look for Hope Summers, which is, I think, one of the things that happens in AVX. So it's them trying to do that, and they fail miserably at it because the Phoenix, of course, blasts right through them and gets to Earth, as we know from reading AVX, which is a terrible book, but that does happen in it, is that the Phoenix does arrive to Earth. So we have a couple issues there with no Flash. And then after they stop Max Fury, well, Max Fury dies, but after they stop Father and get into this final battle, the one who saves the day, actually, Captain Britain, he gets sent to another realm with a couple members, I think Hawkeye, and they have to deal with the werewolf people and the vampire Wolverine and the Frankenstein and the evil spirit Dr. Voodoo guy and stuff. So they're in another world because of Otherworld. They got sucked into this other realm, and they have to deal with that, and they fight their way back to the main Marvel universe where they have to fight the robots and stuff. So that was kind of cool seeing them go through all that and fight their way back, then teaming up with everyone. I think Black Widow quits the team at one point because of what's going on, but I think she gets roped back in somehow towards the end. And they all just have this big battle with these AI robots at the end. And the one who saves the day is actually Jim Hammond. He realizes, I think it's Flash or Hawkeye. Hawkeye has to make a choice. He's like, if I kill this person, because they have this whole message that Avengers don't kill, Avengers don't kill. But Venom, he straight up a couple times, he's interrogating people and he just drops them off buildings. And then the other Avengers like grab the guy and are like, whoa, 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 what are you doing? Like you dropped him. And he's like, yeah. He's like, we got our information. He's like, are you kidding me? He could have died. And Flash's like, so what if he did? He's a scumbag. He's a terrorist. Like, I don't care if he dies. And Flash just has that soldier mentality still. And plus, he's still Venom. Venom doesn't really care about bad guy human life either. So I kind of like that dynamic a little bit where Hawkeye's trying to be a better person, and then he has to deal with someone who kind of is like him, I thought that was a good dynamic between him, between Hawkeye and Flash, and they have to work their way towards accepting each other by the end. Because, like I said, Hawkeye at the beginning of the story doesn't want Venom on the team, but Venom comes through at the end and helps save the day. And I really loved all that. I love that whole build up and that characterization of them and kind of the way they butt heads, because it reminded me of the way Cap and Hawkeye used to butt heads in older Avengers books. And like I said, I'm not an expert on any of that stuff, but some of those old things I have read. And I remember when Hawkeye went to the Thunderbolts and how that was. And so it just kind of felt like, oh, this is cool. This is Hawkeye having to deal with someone who's just like him, at that age. And I was like, so I kind of dug that. So they fight the AI. And so Hawkeye has to make this choice. I'm going to have to kill. I kept saying the Avengers don't kill, Avengers don't kill, but I'm going to have to kill this person to save the human race. And I'm going to have to live with killing, and wiping out an entire species of robotic people. I'm gonna have to live with that for the rest of my life. And he's like, but I gotta do it because no one else is around to do it. So he pulls his, bow and arrow back, and he's getting ready to shoot. And then Jim Hammond shows up, who has been wounded through most of the book because he got wounded early on in the story. He's been healing for most of it, but then the bad guys broke him out, and they're like, you're our grandfather. You're the first AI of, the Marvel Universe, essentially. You were built to fight Nazis, and we all are descendants of you. And so, and they were, and it's funny because they were, the crown thing they were using, it connected them to a realm called the Abyss, which is apparently all black, and they kept referencing Null, but not Null the character, just Null, just the original spelling of the word Null. And they're like, yeah, return to the Null, return to the Abyss, that's all black. We want to just wipe everything out and bring everything back to darkness. This isn't, we're not tapped into heaven or hell. It's the Abyss. It's the in between. And I was like, well, that's kind of cool, because that's something they talk on in Supernatural. It's called the Empty on Supernatural. And that's one of my favorite things they've done on the show post season five, is the Empty and the character that runs the Empty. And the Empty is a place where all angels and demons go after they die, and they just go there and they sleep, and that's it. And I kind of they sleep forever, so I kind of like that. And so I was like, oh, that's cool. That reminds me of Supernatural, but it also makes me think of Null being like the actual villain Null now. So I thought that was kind of when I was reading it, they kept saying Null, and I was like, I know it's not a K in front of that Null, but it was still like they kept talking about the black and the realm of the black, and Null is there and stuff like that. And I was like, and and of course they're not talking about the character, but it was still neat. And I'm like, oh, okay, they reference that a couple times in this. But at the end, Jim Hammond decides, okay, I know these are my descendants and my children to some degree, like not really, but to some degree, the closest as an AI I'll ever get, probably. He comes back after being wounded, and after they broke him out, like the villains broke him out and tried to turn him evil. And he was sitting on the battlefield deciding which side he was going to take. And then finally, at the end, he decides to make the choice instead of Hawkeye, and he takes the choice away from Hawkeye so that Hawkeye doesn't have to live with it forever. And Jim Hammond kills all the robotic people, and they all shut down. And then all the humans that were brainwashed get returned back to that. So Jim Hammond chooses humanity over his own kind at the end. And I thought that was really great. Actually, I thought that moment was handled really, really well in the story. So I end up really digging that. And at the end, like I said, after Venom frees Valkyrie from being possessed, the two of them actually take down some major villains between the two of them, and they save the kid as well. And the mom comes back as like a villain at one point. The mom that was, because she was captured by the bad guys, and they reprogrammed her, and they convinced her that she could be evil, and that she wants her son back so that she can program him to be like them. But at the end, the team puts their stuff aside. They take down Black Ant, who betrayed them, and they make a sacrifice to teleport the kid to safety. And I thought that was pretty awesome. So the book ended really strong, I thought. But there wasn't a ton of Venom in this. I was surprised. Like I said, with the amount of issues that were here, it's like 15 books spread over three graphic novels. I was surprised, that there's not like an hour, 2 hours worth of stuff to talk about. I think I summed it up fairly well. Of course I'm missing some things, but those were the stuff that I can remember in my head that I really enjoyed of those issues. So that covers all of Secret Avengers now, and we'll end this issue or this episode with issue number 16, which is called Clemency, which is another one part or single issue story where Agent Venom gets to fight against one of my favorite villains from Spider-Man, which is Philip Urich, who was a hero at first as the Green Goblin in the 90s. He had his own series for 13 issues, and then he joined a group called the Losers for a while, and then after that, in Spider-Man Big Time, he came back as the new Hobgoblin. And so now he's here as the new Hobgoblin, and he's trying to kill the human fly. So the human fly has been captured. This is a character that obviously Flash has run into before, prior to this. and he's on a bullet train being transferred to a prison, and so that's when Hobgoblin shows up, being paid to free, it's Human Fly, and so Human Fly is like, no, they want to kill me. You got to keep me safe. He's like, I just want to live so I can see my son. He's like, there's a place in a train station back in New York, and there's a locker there, and there's a key that will open that locker. And in there is a letter to my son. He's like, I just want that letter delivered. So no matter what, whoever comes and attacks me, whoever tries to kill me and silence me, please, Venom, promise me, because Venom is like his guard. He's got to make sure he gets transported safely. And I don't know if that was like an Avengers mission that he got sent on to do that. Maybe this is during AVX or something. I have no idea. But anyway, Venom is like his guard, and he has to watch him. So he's like, please, as my guard, make sure I get there safe, and if I don't, make sure that letter gets to my son. And he goes, and the letter will tell you where my son is so you can deliver it. And so Flash says, okay. He's like, I'll make you that promise. So Flash is connecting a little bit and empathizing with the villain, Human Fly, who spits acid out, and he's like kind of like a fly, like Jeff Goldblum, like he's mutated a little bit, but he's still kind of humanoid too. So he's a creepy looking villain. And so he finds out that one of the other guards in the train is actually Philip Urich in disguise, who turns into Hobgoblin and strikes back and tries to kill Venom with his fire sword. So they go at it, they get into it. The fight is really great, and at one point Venom gets knocked off the train, and he's got to work his way back to the train, and he does it by riding a motorcycle, and he ramps off of like a building or off of like a freeway or something, and lands on the train again, and uses the motorcycle to crash into Hobgoblin and send him off flying. And there's a great fight at one point between Hobgoblin and Human Fly, where Human Fly is spitting acid at Hobgoblin and makes him drop his flame sword. And then that's when he gets hit by the motorcycle, which is pretty awesome. So then Venom has a gun. He lifts it up and he tells Human Fly, get back in your cage. And then meanwhile, there's a guard nearby that's holding onto the top of the train, and he's slipping. He's about to fall off. And Human Fly goes, look, man, all I want to do is go get that letter and deliver it to my son, and you can, meet me there at the train station. You can arrest me there. I just want to make sure I get that letter. So he's like, but you got to save that guard, or you're going to shoot me. Like, what's it going to be? So Flash, feeling empathy towards Human Fly, is like, fine. He saves the guard, and Human Fly gets away. And Flash's like, all right, well, we got to get to that locker so I can, cut him off at the pass, make sure he doesn't escape, and we get that letter to his son because I made him a promise. So then Flash goes there, gets to the safe, or the locker that has it, opens up the locker, sees the letter inside, opens up the letter, and it says, I don't have a son. Which I thought, wow, that's awesome. That is really, really awesome. So of course Flash is now pissed, because he got played, someone played on his emotions and his empathy, him being someone who never connected with his father and thought his father was trash. He was thinking, oh man, Human Fly's son probably feels the same way towards Human Fly as I did towards my father. So Human Fly, whether he knew it or not, knew exactly, or ended up hitting Flash right where it mattered most, in the heart. So I thought that was pretty great. And at the end, when he sees that note, it says, I don't have a son, he just like crumbles the letter, and he's like, you motherfucker. Like, he's so pissed off. But he got played, man. He got played, son. So I thought this was fun. Like, issue 15 and 16 by Remender were really good, and Secret Avengers was like pretty good. Like, I would say my rating on 15 and 16, I would probably give both those books a 4 to 4.5 out of 5. I thought they were really strong single issue stories, especially the emotional stuff in issue 15 with Flash and Betty and stuff like that, and Peter and all that. The only thing I didn't like in that book was Eddie Brock killing other symbiotes, and then same with Eddie Brock killing Scream, and all that. I didn't like any of that. But issue 16, the standalone story with the Human Fly and Philip Urich Hobgoblin, love that. That was a really good one. Secret Avengers, I would probably give it like a 3.5 to 4 out of 5. Not enough Venom in it, considering he's a new member of the team. The whole third trade paperback, he's only in the annual. It's just like a standalone story where they go off on a little mission together, that I don't know. It wasn't like a big deal, and I actually can't even remember too much what happened in an annual. So maybe we'll cover it in another episode, or maybe we'll just, again, I can't think of what happened in that annual at all. So I guess it wasn't too important. But that's all. The third volume, if you buy these, buy volume 1 and 2 of Secret Avengers. Volume 3 only has an annual in it. So if you want to go find that annual separately and not spend the money for the third trade, Venom's pretty much not in the third trade at all. He's just in that annual. So yeah, so not a ton of them. Out of these 15 issues, Venom was probably in like 7 or 8 of them, maybe 9, but that was it. That's all the Venom we got in those 3 trade paperbacks. But yeah, still fun stuff. So if you haven't checked this stuff out, issues 15 and 16 or Secret Avengers by Rick Remender, I recommend them still. Even though I didn't love some of Secret Avengers, I still liked it enough to where I would recommend it to you guys. And obviously, even if I hate stuff, I still recommend you check it out for yourself and make up your own mind. So if you do have a different opinion of me on any of this stuff, let me know what that is down in the comments below, and we'll continue our conversation down there as always. And coming up in another episode, you know, I'll talk about the Savage Six. We'll get into that. That'll be our final Remender Flash story. So we'll get into that in an upcoming episode here soon. And then we'll dip over to the Thunderbolts and talk about him joining the Thunderbolts. Then we'll get into Minimum Carnage and the Cullen Bunn stuff for Venom. And I'll probably just cover all of that in like one-hour episode and break it into 2 parts. So that way we can fly through the Cullen Bunn stuff. Not because I don't want to spend time on it, but just because we got like less than 20 episodes left this season, and I want to make sure we cover as much of the Flash Thompson stuff as we can. So we'll get into that very soon too. So again, let me know down below and we'll continue the conversation down there. Thanks for watching the show. As always, like, share, subscribe, all that fun stuff, and I'll see you in the future. Peace.